Welcome to part two of this tutorial series where we're creating these Rocky Mountains in Blender. So in part one, we had created the Rocky Mountain objects and we also added a camera and placed it in the scene. And in this part, we're going to continue to edit the scene. We're going to move the camera around and kind of edit the environment to get the composition how we like. And then we're also going to set up the lighting. And then in part three, we'll be doing the materials and the rendering and the compositing. The project files for this tutorial are available on my Gumroad store and my Patreon page, so if you'd like to purchase the project files and help support this channel, the links will be in the description. And some great ways to help support the channel here on YouTube is by checking out the YouTube memberships by clicking right down there on the join button next to the subscribe button. And if you enjoy this video and you'd like to send me a little tip, you can also use the super thanks feature here on YouTube underneath this video. So I actually don't want to be able to see any of this ground right here, so what I'm going to do is click right up here to select the camera, and if you're not in the camera view, you can press the zero on the number pad to go in and out of the camera view. So I'm going to press G to grab, and then I'm going to hit Z and bring it down on the Z axis because I want the camera to kind of be looking up at the mountains. Then I'm going to double tap the R key, and that's going to turn on the trackball rotation, and I can hold down the shift key to make my movements more sensitive, and I'm just going to move the camera up like that. And then I also want to turn up the focal length of the camera. So if you click right over here on the object data properties, right here on the focal length, I want to turn this up to like 70, and that way it's going to zoom in the camera a little bit and make everything look a bit more flat, and I do think it looks a bit nicer. It also helps to make the mountains look a bit bigger. And then I can press G to grab, and I can double tap the Z key, and that's going to move the camera in and out, and I can move my mouse, and I can bring it forward and backward just to move the camera around, and I just want to find a view that I like. So something like that is pretty good. And then I also want to select this mountain here, which is closest, and I want to bring this down a little bit, so I'll press G to grab, and I can also see that I have the proportional editing turned on because there's that little circle there. So to turn the proportional editing off, I'm just going to click on this button right here to turn it off. And then I'm also going to press R to rotate. Let's hit Z to rotate it on the Z axis, and I just want to rotate the mountain slightly so that you can kind of see that back mountain right there. And then I also want to edit the shape of the object a little bit, so I will press the Tab key to go into edit mode, and then in edit mode I do want to turn on the proportional editing, so I'm going to click on this button right here to turn on the proportional editing. And then what I can do is just select a vertex, and I can press G to grab, and that's going to move the vertices around. And then if I scroll with my scroll wheel, I can move the mountain around, and you can see if the circle is bigger, it's going to pull around more of the vertices which are nearby. So I'm going to bring this over here, I might select a vertex there, bring this over a little bit, something like that, maybe also bring this one down a little bit, and I can just kind of play around with the shape of the mountain if I want to change it. And then also I don't want to see any of this ground here, so I'm going to press the A key to deselect everything, and I can press B for the box select, and I'm just going to box select some of these vertices here, and then press G to grab, bring it down, and I can scroll my mouse wheel to make the size of the proportional editing bigger, and I can bring that down. I can also kind of navigate over here and select a vertex and press G to grab, kind of move this down here, and basically this whole ground area, I just want to move it down to get it out of the way. And later on in the tutorial, we will actually be deleting these extra vertices because you won't be able to see them in the render. So if we delete them, it'll make the scene a bit faster and there won't be as much topology. You can press the zero on the numpad to go into the camera view and just make sure that you can't really see the ground. I can press the Tab key to go back to object mode, and then I could bring this up a little bit if I wanted to, and maybe rotate it a little bit. Alright, so something like that is pretty good. Now, these mountains right here, I want these mountains to cover this area, so I'm going to hit R to rotate, and then let's rotate it on the X axis, and I want to rotate it down a little bit, and I can also bring these mountains down on the Z axis and place them about there. And then I can select these back mountains here, and I want to do the same thing, so I'm going to hit R to rotate. Let's rotate it on the X axis and kind of rotate it down like this so that I can see the mountains a bit better. I don't want to rotate them too far, but just a bit down. And I could also scale this up if I want to and kind of move it around to get whichever mountains you want to see. So if you like these mountains over here, you could move that over, or you could move this back over here. Just kind of play around with the composition. So something like that is pretty good. So up here, we're going to have some sky with clouds, and then there's some mountains far away, and then there's this close mountain right here with this ridge. So I'm going to press Ctrl+S to save the Blender file again. So once the mountains are move to where you want. I'm just going to delete all of these extra vertices because this scene is pretty dense. If I select all the objects, I'm going to hold down the shift key and select all the objects. I'm going to press the tab key to go into edit mode, and this is going to take us into the multi-object editing. So we are in edit mode of all these objects and we can edit them all at once. So you can see that these objects are pretty dense. They're very high poly, and I'm not doing an animation and I'm not going to be moving the camera around. So I like how the camera is and I like how the environment is. So I'm going to delete all of the vertices all around here, and that's just going to speed up the viewport and the render will be a bit faster and it won't be quite as laggy because there won't be any extra vertices. So if you are doing like an animation or you want to render this from different views, then you may not want to do this, but this is the only view that I'm going to be rendering. So I'm just going to delete these vertices. So in edit mode, I'm going to hold the Z button down and then I'm going to move my mouse into the wireframe view. I can now zoom out far away, and I'm going to press B for the box select, and I'm just going to click and drag a box around where the camera can't see. Also press B for the box select again, drag over and just box select where the camera can't see. I think I'll do that again and select some of the vertices a bit closer up, and then zoom out here and press B for the box select, and just box select these vertices here. So basically we've selected all of these vertices which the camera can't see, and you can see that's actually like half of all the mesh. So we can delete this and the topology of the scene will be much lower. So let's hit X to delete, and I can click on vertices. So now the vertices are deleted, I can go back to solid view, and you can see now the scene is much less dense. Now I'm actually gonna press Control Z to undo that, because there were actually some faces here which were deleted. So what I'm gonna do is hold down the Z button, go back to wireframe, and I'm gonna press B for the box select again, but this time I'm gonna click and drag with my middle mouse wheel, and I'm gonna drag over here and then let go, and that way it'll deselect the vertices instead of selecting them. And I can press X to delete, and let's delete the vertices. So I can hold down the Z button, go back to solid view, and just make sure that there isn't any faces cut out that you can't see. So that all looks fine. And if you wanted to, because we're in edit mode, you could press G to grab, kind of move this down, and because we have the proportional editing on, it's gonna move around the vertices which are nearby. Now also right over here, there's some vertices which you can't see behind the mountain. So I'm gonna hold down the Z button, go to wireframe, and then I'm going to press the C key to go to the circle select. And I'm going to scroll my mouse wheel out so that the circle is a little bit bigger. And then I can click and drag, and I'm just going to select these vertices here, and I can scroll to make it smaller, and I can select some of these here, and I'm just going to go along and select these ones here because these are all behind the mountain, so you're not going to be able to see it in the render. And then to get rid of the circle select, you can press the escape key, and that'll get rid of the circle select, and I can press the zero on the numpad to go into the camera view. And you can see the camera can't actually see any of those vertices, so I can press X to delete, and let's delete the vertices. And it looks like right here, it looks like we got rid of something I didn't actually want. So I'll press Control Z to undo that. And you can see that one vertex was selected. I don't know why that was selected, but I can just hold down the shift key and then click on that vertex to deselect it. And then I can press X to delete, and let's delete the vertices. All right, so that's much better. And if you wanted to, you could continue to delete more and more of the mountain that you can't see, but I'm just gonna leave it like that. So I will press the tab key to go back to object mode. Now I wanna make this mountain much more detailed because you can see it actually is a bit low poly, and we are looking at it pretty close. These mountains over here, these mountains are really far away, so I don't really care that they're a bit low poly, but I do want this mountain to be much more high poly. So what I'm gonna do is add some modifiers to give this object more detail. So let's click right over here on the modifier properties, and I'm gonna click on add modifier, and here under generate, let's add the subdivision surface modifier. So this will subdivide the mesh and give it more geometry, and you can see it's much smoother. Now right here on the render and viewport, I'm gonna turn this both up to 2 so that it has much more geometry, and now it is much more smooth. Now I don't really like how smooth it is. I want it to still look kind of rough, and I want to give it much more detail to make it look more like a cliff face or a rocky mountain. So what I'm going to do is click on add modifier, and I'm going to go right down here under deform and add the displace modifier. So we're going to use the displace modifier to displace a procedural texture on the mountain to give it more geometry and make it look more like rock. So on the Displace modifier, let's click on the New button to add a new texture. And then to edit the texture, we can click on this button right here, and this button will take us to the texturing panel. Now right now, the type is set to Image or Movie, but I don't want to add in a texture, I want to use a procedural texture. So right here on the type, I'm going to click on this, and I'm going to change it to Clouds. And the clouds is basically the procedural noise. So now you can see this looks much more detailed. Of course, that doesn't really look like rock, so we are going to edit the clouds. Now to make the displacement look more like rock, I'm going to click here on this noise basis, and there's a bunch of different noise types you can play around with. I'm going to use the Voronoi crackle because that really makes it look a lot more like rock, and I really like how this one looks. Now the size is way too small, so on the size here, I'm just going to turn this to like a 0.6, and that way it is a bit bigger. And then also if we turn the depth up, then it's going to have a lot more detail, so I'm going to turn the depth up to the max of 30, so it has more detail. Now you can see it's still overlapping and it's way too strong, so let's click right back over here on the modifier properties, and right here on the strength, I just want to turn this to like a 0.1 so it's much less strong. But now you can see this has a really cool rock texture, and if you wanted this to be even more detailed, you could turn up the subdivision to 3, so you can see if I turn that up even more, now it's way more detailed, but I don't really think it's necessary to turn up the detail this much. You definitely could if you want to, and it does give a really cool rock texture, but I'm going to turn the render and viewport levels down to just 2. Or if you wanted to, you could leave the levels viewport at 2, but then have it render at 3, and this way it would render with the higher detail. I'm just going to leave it to 2 though, because 2 looks fine. Alright, let's press Ctrl S again to save, and it's now time to do the lighting. So first, let's click right over here to go to the world properties, and I'm going to be adding in an HDRI to get some nice realistic lighting. So if you don't already have a new world, then you can just click on the plus button to add a new world, and if you open up the surface right here, I want to click on color, and I'm going to click on the yellow dot here, and instead of this being a color, I want to change it to an environment texture. And then I can click on open to open up an HDRI. And here's the HDRI that I'm going to be using from polyhaven.com, and I downloaded the 8K HDR version. So links in the description if you'd like to download that HDRI. And I'm just going to click on open image. And this will give us some nice realistic lighting for our mountains. And I'm going to hold down the Z button and move my mouse up into the rendered view so that I can preview the rendered mode. And also I would definitely recommend using cycles render, so if you click right here on the render properties, I would change this to cycles to get the most realism. Now if you're in the rendered view, you can see it's going to render everything around the camera and also what the camera can see. But I want to use the render region so that it'll only preview what the camera can see, and that'll speed up the render preview. So I'm going to press Ctrl B in the camera view, and then I can drag a box around the camera and let go. And this way it'll only render a preview of what the camera can see, and it'll speed up the preview times. Now if you click right back over here to go to the world properties, I actually want to make this a bit darker. So right here on the strength, I'm just going to turn this to a 0.8. And that way the world lighting will be a little bit darker. And then let's also edit the color management. So if you click right back here on the render properties, you can open up the color management tab down here. And I'm going to use the view transform of Filmic, but on the look here, let's click on this, and I'm going to change this to very high contrast. So this is going to pop out the colors and make things more contrasty and saturated. So we do have some nice lighting, and we do have a sunlight right over here, which is shining on the mountains. And you can see the mountains are lit up from this side. But I do want to make a much stronger sunlight, so we're going to be adding a sunlight object. So I'm going to press Shift A, and let's go here to light, and I'm going to add the sunlight. And I can press G to grab, and I'm going to move this up, and I can press R to rotate, just kind of rotate that over, and I'm going to press 7 on the numpad, and that's going to go to top view, and I want to rotate this light over, and basically I want this sunlight to be pretty much at the same position of where the sunlight is in the HDRI, because if the sunlight is at a different angle, then it won't really make sense, and the lighting will look a bit weird, and that's because there is actually some light shining on the mountains from the HDRI, but then this sunlight is going to add even more lighting. So I'm going to rotate this to about the same position. So the sunlight is kind of going to be rotating down just a little bit, and it's going to be here on the side of the mountain. So something like that is really good. And then with the sunlight selected, let's also click right here to go to the object data properties, and we can change the sunlight settings. So right here on the strength, I'm going to turn this up to 3 so that it is a bit brighter. And it does look a little bit strong, but once we add a dark rock material, it won't look quite as bright. And then also right here on the color, I want to make this look a bit more natural. So on the color here, I'm going to make this a slight yellow color. So that is it for the lighting. So I'm just going to press Ctrl S again to save the file. And this is going to wrap it up for this part of the tutorial series. So thank you for watching, and I hope you've been enjoying this so far. And when the last part is released, it'll be right up there on the end screen, and the link will be in the description. And in the last part, we're going to be doing the materials, and then we'll also do the rendering and the compositing to get the finished artwork. And as I mentioned at the beginning of this part, if you'd like to purchase the project files and help support the channel, then you can get that over on my Gumroad store and my Patreon page with the links in the description. But I hope you enjoyed this, thank you for watching, and I will see you in the last part, part 3.